Hello all, this is Dr. Alsip, and in this session we are going to discuss the osteology, better known as the bony structures associated with the anterior neck session. And you will likely immediately notice that some of the structures that we're going to discuss are not actually located in the anterior neck, but we're discussing them here because they could be of importance because of muscle attachments or associated neurovasculature that we're going to be discussing in the session. So it's important to get some of the context here and get an understanding of why we're discussing structures of the cranium when we're in the anterior neck session. So hopefully we'll get some of that context as we move along. I will try to point out some of these important anatomical relationships, but as always in these videos, my primary goal will be to give you guidance on how to identify anatomical structures based on surrounding relationships. So, without further ado, let's get started. All right, we will be identifying specific structures on the occipital and your temporal bones, but before we get into that, let's figure out where the occipital bone is and where the temporal bones are located. And so we are looking at a posterior view of the skull. And I know that because I can see predominantly the occipital bone. I do not see the orbits. I do not see the maxillary teeth very well. So I know I'm looking at the fairly nondescript posterior view. You can see that the prominent bone is the occipital bone, as I noted. This is what's shaded here in purple. And you're always going to have this bump associated with the occipital bone. It is a variable size when looking at this posterior view. It has a very, very long name, so we're going to save that fun name for later. But I always try to locate that when I'm looking at the occipital bone to get my bearings. The occipital bone is unpaired, meaning that there is only one occipital bone. There are not matching bones on each side, like you can see here with the paired parietal bones, that's shaded in green, and your paired temporal bones, which is the other bone that we wanted to identify. When you're looking at a posterior view, you can only see a small portion of the temporal bones, mainly your mastoid process here. You can see the mastoid process over here, and then the small styloid process, which we'll talk about in a subsequent slide. So only a little bit of the temporal bones. One thing I want you to practice throughout this course is looking at these structures from as many points of view as possible. Because just because you understand how something looks, say, from the posterior view that we just saw, doesn't mean you'll be able to identify structures from another view. So things can look quite different. So look at as many images as you can. And we are looking at an inferior view of the cranium here. We know we're not talking about the skull because we don't have the mandible associated with it. And let's identify those two bones again, that occipital bone and the temporal bone. And you can see that bump again here with the occipital bone. For the most part, the occipital bone is going to be here-ish. So this is going to be occipital. And then you can see the temporal bone is going to be just lateral to the occipital bones. So you can see that mastoid process on either side. You can see we're getting fairly complex into portions of the temporal bone here. So occipital bone and temporal bone from an inferior view looks very different than what you saw on that posterior view. Let's look at one last view of these bones. This is what a lateral view. And you can see there is a bone shaded in blue, and this is going to be your temporal bone, specifically your right temporal bone. So you can see quite a bit of a temporal bone from the lateral view. You have a fairly nondescript superior area with an increasing complexity the more inferior you get. And there's that bony bump of the occipital bone. So your occipital bone is here-ish. So this is occipital. All right, now let's spend a second figuring out what type of view we are looking at here. We like to call this particular view cranial base superior, meaning that we're looking at the base of the cranium from a superior view, kind of looking into the skull. I also like to refer to this as an internal view of the cranial base because at this point we are looking into the cranium where the brain would have sat during life, but the brain's been removed, and we're just looking at the osteological structures. So looking at this image over here, just want to kind of note that from basically here up, that portion's been removed. We call this the calvaria, in order to be able to look into this region. So we are going to spend a lot of the course in this internal view of the cranial base, or the superior view of the cranial base, so please start getting familiar with it. Finding the bones that we just discussed, here is your occipital bone. This is also part of the occipital bone, so kind of here-ish. And then you see this kind of rock-like portion over here of the inside of the cranial base. These are going to be your temporal bones. So this petrous part of the temporal bone is a very important region. You actually have your middle and your inner ear housed in that region. So we're going to come back to that over and over again. Now I want you to focus on this region kind of right here between the occipital and the temporal bones, this circle here, or this opening. We are in anatomy now, so we're not going to call that a hole. We are going to call these holes foramina, if we're talking about the plural, or foramen, if you're talking singular. So specifically, these regions right here are called the jugular foramina. So whereas most foramina are pretty uniformly circular or ovular, you can see here some other examples of foramina, this foramen, or the jugular foramen, is going to be very irregularly shaped. You will very commonly hear it referred to as that. So bone forms around neurovascular structures embryologically. The jugular foramen is going to form around what is called your IJV, or your internal jugular vein. So that variable pressure of the vein is the reason why you have this irregular shape of the foramen. You'll often hear anatomists say the internal jugular vein traverses the jugular foramen. So if we have you know a foramen, make sure you understand what is traversing it. In addition to the IJV, you're going to have three cranial nerves that are also going to traverse the jugular foramen to exit the skull. Of most importance to this session is the accessory nerve, or cranial nerve 11. And it's important for this session because it's going to efferently innervate your sternocleidomastoid, which we're going to talk about, as well as your trapezius muscles. Now here is an inferior lateral view of the jugular foramen. So there's that foramen magnum. And here is that irregularly shaped jugular foramen. So you can see it not only from an internal view of the cranium, but also an external view, or an inferior view, of the base of the skull. Okay, moving back to an inferior view of the cranium, let's focus on some of these landmarks of the occipital bone. And starting with this large dominant hole right here, which is your foramen magnum. This is probably the most distinct structure when we're talking about the occipital bone. It is here at the foramen magnum that there is a transition from the brainstem to the spinal cord. So it's right at the foramen magnum that that transition occurs. Additionally, that oddball accessory nerve is going to come off of the spinal cord and ascend, or come back up, through the foramen magnum before it immediately exits or traverses the jugular foramen that we just saw a moment ago. Okay? So that accessory nerve is coming up for both the foramen magnum as well as the jugular foramen. So it will ascend through the foramen magnum, and it will traverse and exit the cranium through the jugular foramen. Also, the vertebral arteries are going to ascend through the foramen magnum on its way to provide blood supply to the brain. Now, flanking the foramen magnum, you are going to have your occipital condyle. So you can see both in the straight inferior view as well as this inferior lateral view. I think you can kind of see a bit more how it's kind of this oblong, kind of disc-like shaped region. These condyles are going to articulate or form a joint with the first cervical vertebrae, often referred to as the atlas. So this joint between the occipital bone and the atlas is called the atlanto-occipital joint, so very aptly named. So basically how that skull is going to meet the rest of the body. Okay, finding structures of the temporal bone and moving back to this lateral view, we're going to focus mainly on these posterior portions with these two inferior projections of the temporal bone. The first is going to be wider and thicker, and this is going to be the mastoid process. And you can actually palpate your own mastoid process by feeling under your ears. So that bump right underneath there, that's your mastoid process. This is going to be the superior attachment site for the sternocleidomastoid. Anterior to the mastoid process is going to be the styloid process. So much thinner, it's shaped more like a pin or a stylus. This one is not easily palpable and is often broken postmortem or after death in many skull specimens because of how thin and breakable this portion of the bone is. Also of the temporal bone is the external opening of the carotid canal. And I'm just going to spend a moment locating those on the inferior lateral view and the inferior view. This is where the ICA, or your internal carotid artery, is going to enter into the skull in order to be the other main supply to the brain. So we talked about the vertebral arteries coming up through the foramen magnum to supply the brain. Well, your internal carotid arteries are your other main supply of the brain, and this is how they are getting into the skull. So internal carotid artery is going to be a branch of the common carotid, which we're going to see fairly well in the anterior neck dissection. Okay, moving away from the cranium and to the other component of the skull is the mandible, often colloquially referred to as the lower jaw. This will be a very important area for you in your career as it's housing these lower or mandibular teeth. But let's focus on the basics of the bony parts. And there are three major areas we want you to be aware of now. The first is this horizontal portion of the mandible, referred to as the body. So this portion right here is the body. The base is basically this entire inferior region of the mandible. So anything when you're kind of putting your hand up against your mandible at the bottom, that's going to be the base. And then the vertical portion of the mandible is going to be the rami, or the ramus if you're talking singular. Looking at a lateral view, you can see a much better view of the ramus of the mandible. You can see how vertical it is in comparison to the more horizontal body. And you can see these two superior projections of the ramus. We will come back to those in the future, but they're important in terms of muscle attachment as well as joint formation. So this is going to be the mandibular part of your TMJ joint. Moving inferiorly, we have the hyoid bone, which lies in the anterior part of the neck at about the C3 or cervical vertebrae 3 level. It is located between the mandible and your thyroid cartilage. So if you're feeling your anterior neck, typically that more prominent projection is going to be your thyroid cartilage. And kind of in between that mandible and the thyroid cartilage is where your hyoid will sit. It is unique among bones for its isolation from other bones of the skeleton. Sometimes you hear it referred to as free-floating. There are a lot of muscular and ligamentous attachments, so I wouldn't necessarily say free-floating, but you may see that in other literature. It is a very unique looking bone, so it's pretty hard to mistake this for another type. So very U-shaped and fairly thin. Next, we have the clavicle, which is colloquially referred to as the collarbone. But as we are in anatomy now, we of course won't do that. We will always call it the clavicle. It is another very distinct looking bone. So you can see this kind of double curve associated with the shaft or the body of the clavicle. It's going to be important in connecting the upper limb to the trunk and will be particularly important in terms of the root of the neck. So this one will come up in these upcoming three sessions. Now it will connect to the trunk via the sternum, which is what we are looking at here. This is a flat, longer bone in the middle and anterior part of the thoracic cage. The sternum is going to consist of three parts, and we're going to focus on this most superior part first, which is referred to as the manubrium, or the manubrium. This is the handle of the sternum. It is the widest and the thickest part. And if you palpate at the very top of the manubrium, or the top of the sternum, you will likely run across the suprasternal or the jugular notch. You'll hear it referred to either way. So this concave center right here of the superior border of the manubrium. This is a very, very, put a little asterisk next to this, palpation landmark. Very important. So do make sure you can locate this on a picture of the sternum, but also be able to find on yourself for use in terms of future patients. So very important palpation landmark. Okay, so this is all the osteology that we're going to cover for this session. We took this nice and slow to go over some of the big picture concepts and get an understanding of how to start thinking through these views and anatomical relationships. We will review most of these structures throughout the course, so these are going to come up over and over again, but now's the time to start getting familiar with them. Thank you, and as always, please feel free to reach out to me with any questions. Please have a wonderful day.